The Radical. Fundamental principles of freedom, rational self-interest, and individual rights. This is The Yaron Brook Show.
All right, everybody. Welcome to Yaron Brook Show on this, Wednesday. Wednesday evening. Hope you're having a great week so far. It's the end of May. It is hard to believe it is the end of May. But it is. And already 5 months into the year. What a year it's been. All right. So I've been watching the show Billions. We're already on season 5 of Billions. I don't know how many of you have seen Billions, but I particularly enjoyed the first 2 seasons. I thought it was quite original, and any show that actually has finance in it is unusual and rare. And any show that is, I've talked about this before, that depicts district attorneys for the Southern District of New York as viciously as this show has. Whoops, I have to turn on the camera, that's true. Thank you. All right, any show that depicts the district attorney, the Southern District of New York, the way this show does was worth seeing first 2 seasons. I'd say after that, kind of the show went downhill a little bit, kind of lost its focus. But season 5, the season I just started watching, I think there are 4 episodes in, I've watched 3, is refocused. But also season 5 is clearly out to make a statement. That is, this is the season where they're getting more philosophical. They're talking more about capitalism. They're talking more about the system. They're talking more about character. So Bob Lee Axelrod in the season is finally worth over $10 billion. So he's made it into the centibillionaire club. And the season is a confrontation between him and another centibillionaire hedge fund manager. And the contracts between them, Bobby Axelrod is rough, tumble, proud, unapologetic. We'll see. Wrong, but unapologetic and aggressive. His opponent is soft, politically correct, says the right things, does the right things, big into charity, big into giving back. And it's an interesting conflict between the two. And I'm going to show you a bit from it that is related to the difference between the two hedge fund managers. That's right, Desi, centibillionaire would be 100. Okay, so they're both Desi billionaires. Sorry, Desi. They're not that many centibillionaires. Desi billionaires, yes. So both these billionaires represent 2 different approaches to wealth, 2 different approaches to hedge funds, 2 different approaches to, I guess, presenting themselves to the public. And it's going to be interesting through the different episodes to see the contrast between the two. What you're going to see, and I'll show you 2 bits of Bobby Axelrod, the billionaire hedge fund manager, hero of the show. You'll see how mixed up the writing is. You'll see how confused it is. You see how much right there is, and yet, it has to undercut itself. It cannot be completely right, right? Capitalism cannot be good. Capitalism cannot be right. Being ambitious, unapologetic, confident hedge fund manager has to have its limits. It cannot be true. You cannot be a good guy, really. At the end, you cannot. And this is the dance that the show is had from the beginning. On the one hand, Bobby is a larger-than-life, life-loving, big, boisterous, proud, unapologetic finance guy who makes money and is incredibly successful. On the other hand, it has to undercut him. So Bobby is often engaged in things that are shady, immoral, you know, insider trading, which is illegal. So put aside immoral, but certainly illegal. Bobby's also obsessed with competition. It's not about being the best that he can be. It's about crushing his opponents. It's about destroying the other people who might be competing with him. So it's not just about the building, creating, making. It's also about the destruction of the other. Bobby also definitely has a sense, he describes this, that it's a zero-sum world. That in order for him to be successful, other people have to be worse off. And you'll see that in the skits that I show you, right? So he's definitely doesn't have an understanding of what he does. I mean, it would be unbelievable, because Bobby Axelrod is such a good, larger-than-life character in so many respects, and you'll see, I think, bits of that here. But on the other hand, he is a believer in the zero-sum nature of the world. He's a believer that his success comes at others' expense. He's a believer that others must lose if he is to win. And that's tragic, because here was an unbelievable opportunity, right? Gordon Gekko in Wall Street there's a speech, I'll show you a speech that comes out of Billions, that we'll compare to the Gordon Gekko greed speech. Actually, let me see if I can find the Gordon Gekko's greed speech. One second, let's see. I can show you that as well. Gekko greed speech. I have a feeling we'll be able to find it. Yes, there it is. All right. All right, so I'm going to show you that as well for contrast, because Gordon Gekko's speech is much better than anything Bobby Axelrod does. So we'll contrast the two speeches once we've analyzed Bobby. So, all right, why don't we jump into the video, and we'll analyze it as we go along. So I want to point out the good things, the positive things, the things that actually reflect what makes Bobby a good character, and then the bad things, the things that undermine his character, and the things that undermine the show in terms of its presentation of capitalism. So we're going to start out the first scene. Let me see, that's a scene. We're going to start out with a scene where he and his nemesis, Mike Prince, who is another hedge fund guy, they're both chatting. They're both having a fireside chat at a conference. And again, Mike Prince is presenting this. And this is, unfortunately, I could only get like a minute 44 clip of this. The whole scene is worth watching. It's actually not even a minute 44. It's like less than a minute, I think, the clip itself. But this is what, you know, kind of the Showtime releases, so I'm trying to play by their rules. But I think this is a good clip. It illustrates the point. The whole thing is worth watching, because the whole interview between them, the interplay between them, and the difference philosophically between them is definitely worth seeing in its full, but you'll get a sense of it right here. Mike Prince is very much on the, Warren Buffett, Bill Gates, theory of justice, John Rawls. You're successful because you're lucky. And you'll see that and see Bobby's response to that. All right, let's roll the clip.
This room.
Whoops, sorry, but sorry, I do. Sorry. All right. Here we go. We're going to roll it again.
I don't like everyone in this room, but I do respect everyone in this room, because I know each and every one of you has a portfolio of accomplishments that sets you apart, proves your exceptional qualities. And
So he's basically complimenting everybody there for being successful, for having. He says, I don't like all of you, but you've all been successful. And I respect that. Now, that's good. That's a good way to approach other people. Now, here's Mike Prince's response.
Assume that goes for you, too.
Well, unlike you, I'm not embarrassed to say it.
As I'd expect, because I know your story as much as you know mine, how you came from nothing.
Yeah, it's true. Your dad was an insurance salesman. You ate dinner with him every night. My dad was gonzo. I ate dinner wherever I could.
And yet you were still in the wealthiest state and the wealthiest country in the world, with access to the best health care, schools, infrastructure. And you were born white and male. At a time, that was a huge advantage in the greatest capital market in the history of mankind.
Now note, that's the John Rawls line. You had the right genes. You might have been poor. Okay, but you were poor in the right country. You were poor in the right century. Warren Buffett says this a lot. You were poor in the right city. You were poor in the right period of time. And you were white. You were male. You had every opportunity lined up for you. You were basically, Bobby Axelrod, he tells him, you're basically lucky. Your success is a product of luck. Your success is not your own achievement. Your success is not what you did. Your success is a product of luck. This is John Rawls. This is what Warren Buffett says. This is what Bill Gates says sometimes, although I don't think he believes it. This is the line out there. It's luck. This is what Thomas Piketty of the inequality debate. This is what all the people in inequality, if you watch my inequality debates, this is what they often argue. You didn't build that. This is Obama. You didn't earn that. You didn't make that. You lived in a society. You lived in a place and a time that made it all possible, and you benefited from all those things. So don't take credit for it. Say thank you and share and give back. And that's the argument Mike Prince is doing, and he does it very articulately, quick. Again, the whole interview between the two reflects this difference in attitude. Now notice Axe's response, right? Axe, you know, why don't we listen to it, and then I'll tell you what I would have said and what's good about this and what's bad about it.
The roads were paved for you, Bobby, which is why you were able to move so quickly across them.
Wow. I knew you were racked with guilt, but this takes it to a whole different...
Now, that's great. The fact that he identifies the guilt that motivates Mike Prince, right? Mike Prince, this is the attitude so many American businessmen have. It's an attitude of guilt. It's from the perspective of guilt. I was successful. I can't get credit for that. That would be prideful. That would be sinful. So I must reflect that credit in everybody else. I must not be too proud. I must be humble. That's what Christianity teaches them. That's what John Rawls teaches them. So they come up with a fancy excuse about luck and the roads were paved for you, Bobby. And it's good that Axe identifies the fact that he feels guilty. But let's see what he says next.
Sure, the roads were paved, but I didn't even have a goddamn car. Now, you see, this is where we are different. I don't pretend I'm an ordinary guy, got lucky. I am a monster. A carnivorous fucking monster.
Now, this is the problem, right? So he says, I don't pretend I got lucky. I know who I am. In a sense, I know where my success comes from. I caused my success. My success is mine. And, you know, if it was me or if it was maybe some of you would say, no, I used my mind. I focused. I worked hard. I took that energy and focused it on being successful. I didn't exploit anybody. But I achieved success using my mind, my focus. And you know what? There are a million kids who grew up just like me. There are a billion kids who grew up in the century with this capital market, with these opportunities, maybe with even better opportunities than mine. And they didn't succeed and I did. Why? Here are the characteristics that made me successful. But what are the characteristics that Bobby Axelrod identifies in himself as success? He's a monster. Now, monster here reflects carnivorous monster, not just a monster. A monster that eats others. A monster that exploits. A monster that takes advantage of. Note, there are two views of human behavior in the world out there. You can be an altruist, sacrifice, give to others, pretend that your success is luck, be guilt-ridden, give back, contribute, be humble. Or you can be a greedy, exploiting SOB. There is, selfishness is. So you can either sacrifice to others or sacrifice others to you. Now, it's not like Mike Prince, the other hedge fund manager, sacrifices much. But he's on that side, as that is virtue. Bobby Axelrod says, to hell with virtue. To hell with that morality. I'm going to sacrifice anybody I need to sacrifice for my success as needed, as necessary. Now, neither one of them completely takes that philosophy seriously. So Mike Prince is not Mother Teresa. And Bobby Axelrod is not a murdering, thieving, you know, lying, stealing, cheating SOB. But that is the underlying premise. That vision of what is right, that vision of what is good underlies both of them. So Bobby believes that, even though he doesn't lie and cheat and steal, he manipulates. He does things he shouldn't probably do. He shouldn't do morally. But he doesn't go all out. He doesn't really exploit other people in the way that he pretends. He's not that carnivorous. But that's his only explanation. That's to him what self-interest means. That to him what is the best that he can do to explain himself. He's a carnivorous monster. He won't give in to this bogus idea that it's luck. He won't give in to this bogus idea that he didn't earn it. He earned it. He worked hard for it. He deserves credit for it. But what was that work like? Well, it is the work of a monster, a carnivorous monster. It's so sad. The sadness is for both of these guys. They're both incredibly successful. They're both really, really good at what they do. And yet neither one has the right ethic. Neither one has the right morality. Neither one has the right view of the world, view of life, that allows him to have the happiness, allows him to have the pride, the proper pride, and allows him to really embrace their own success. I mean, to me, the fact that they have billions and billions of dollars, still, I feel sorry for them. Still, I feel the injustice. Because these should be incredibly happy people. They're incredibly successful. They've done good. Particularly Bobby, who's come up from nothing, had nothing, and been incredibly successful. And why he can't enjoy that? Why he can't embrace that? Because of the morality of altruism, the guilt that eats at them. And that they've never been provided with guidance. Bobby needs to read Atlas Shrugged. He needs the objectivist philosophy in order to be able to live up morally, live up in terms of his life to what he's achieved financially. Now, note too that Bobby, throughout all the seasons, is constantly looking for himself. He's looking for a purpose. He's not happy. Actually, this season starts with him and his number two guy in a tent in some Indian reservation in Canada doing some drug with some Indian thing, some psychedelic, trying to find himself, trying to achieve happiness. You know, to his credit, he says, it didn't do it for me. The only thing that would do it for him is a philosophy. It's a morality. A morality that says that, yes, you should pursue your own self-interest, Bobby. And that's good that you pursue your own self-interest, Bobby. Here's some principles to help you pursue your own self-interest, Bobby. Stop pretending that you're a monster. You're not a monster. You're a benefactor. You're a hero. You're one of the good guys. And part of what undercuts your happiness, Bobby, is that you're constantly competing with others. Instead of competing, be the best that you can be. Stop trying to destroy other people. Think about how you can achieve more for you. Giving somebody like Bobby Axelrod that moral thumbs up is revolutionary. It would change his life if he could really integrate that. He would be happy. All right, let's do one more clip from Billion. So this is a clip where Bobby Axelrod is speaking in front of his son's school. It's a private school. It's a boarding school. And his son built some kind of computer to mine Bitcoin in the basement of the school, blew out the electric fuses for the entire town around it, and is basically about to be expelled from the school. And with the idea that he broke the codes and he did all this stuff. And Bobby comes there and he basically finds dirt on the headmaster and keeps him in the school. And part of the deal is not only does his son get to stay in the school, but Bobby gets to address the student body at the school and give a little speech. So here's Bobby's one and a half minute speech to the school. Notice again, the stuff you would cheer together with stuff that is cringeworthy. That combination. Here it goes.
Your headmaster was kind enough to seat me the mic for this morning's lesson. And I'm here to give you a little bit about what the school has been holding back from you. The goddamn truth about Darwin, scarcity, and the world you actually live in.
Notice Darwin, you know, the Darwin evolution, only the fittest survive, survival of the fittest, zero sum. Scarcity, zero sum. And the world in which you live in, he's gonna argue, is zero sum. If it's a zero sum world, where do you wanna be? Exploited? Be doing the exploiting. But that's the setup. The setup is immediately buying into all the negative, wrong views of life, of the world that are out there.
It's not the warm, swaddled place your headmaster and your parents have told you about. No. It's populated by people like me.
There he is, the monster.
Who will tear you apart.
Yeah, tear them apart. Physical violence.
Nature didn't select me. I selected myself.
Now that's beautiful, right? Nature didn't select me. I select myself. That's free will. That's my ambition. That's my focus. That's my energy, my responsibility. Feeding off of the previous clip that I showed you, right? That's great. But he selected himself to do what?
By harnessing my nature. My son wasn't pulling a prank. He was trying to earn. And
that's
if he
good.
Broke the school's code, it's because the code is wrong. Asked him to go against the DNA, which is telling each of you to be greedy. Yes, be hungry. Subjugate and conquer.
Subjugate and conquer. Subjugate and conquer. That to him is the essence, right? It's exploit or be exploited. If those are the options in life, what would you rather be? The exploiter. Somebody mentioned that this is like Yaron, and yeah, this is very much like Yaron. Here's an incredibly able person who has come to the conclusion that the only way he can win is by exploiting others. The only way he can be successful is by exploiting others. Now, he doesn't go all out. He doesn't become a monster. He's not a monster in the show. But he's unhappy because he lives in a world that he has created in his own mind that is a zero-sum world. And I don't think you can enjoy a zero-sum world.
Because that's who we are. That's what we are. Capitalism harnesses that better than any other economic model on earth.
Now, if you replaced what he just said with self-interest, then yeah, capitalism does harness self-interest. I'm not sure for what purpose. What do you harness something for? What? But it harnesses, it allows that freedom, which is what creates the wealth.
Everything we have is because of capitalism.
Because of capitalism, absolutely.
So someone had an incentive to get up off his ass, to out-invent, to out-earn, yes, and to subjugate others.
Subjugate others. So he just said, everything you have is because of capitalism, could be out of one of my speeches. Had an incentive to get up and earn and produce and create all good stuff and to subjugate others. In other words, he's just buying into Marxist theory and he's saying, yeah, and I agree with Marx, but as long as I'm doing the exploiting, it's cool.
Less capable, less intelligent, less ambitious, less lucky to make those capitalistic dreams come true. You know what I'm talking about, Headmaster Kessel. The dirty secret you may not want to hear, but you fucking love the result. As will you, soon enough.
Go out there and exploit people. So, what can I say? I love Bobby Axelrod's sense of life. I love his spirit. I love his ambition. I love his cockiness, his unwillingness to bend, his pride, his confidence, his eloquence. What he needs is a moral guide. What he needs is some rational self-interest. What he needs is Ayn Rand. Now, somebody says the writers want you to hate him. They don't really. Not if you watch the show. They don't want you to hate him. They want you to hate him and love him. Just like most people today want you to hate and love capitalism. They want you to hate him and love him. They want you to love his bigger-than-life vivaciousness, which I think most people do. That's why they watch it. And then they want to hate the ideas behind it, but they're not questioning. They're not undercutting what he says. He says everything we have around us is a product of capitalism. I think they acknowledge that. So this goes back to that dichotomy. We've talked about in a number of shows now. You can be good or you can be happy. You can be good or you can be rich. You can be good or you can have a high standard of living. You can't be good and be rich. You can't be good and have a high standard of living. So capitalism produces a high standard of living. But it's bad. Socialism is good, but it sucks because we know it produces poverty. So this dichotomy between happiness and goodness, between success and goodness, this dichotomy is everywhere in our culture, and it is killing us. It is killing us. And again, this is so much. This is Kant right there. This is Immanuel Kant. This is why he is so bad. Because Kant teaches us that you can either be happy Well, good. Good or successful. Can't be both. And you'll see, my guess is, that Mike Pence's attempt to be good and successful will fail in the end. What we'll see is he's not really good. It's just a facade. That he cannot, nobody can be good and successful. At the end of the day, if you're going to be good, you're going to be poor. If you're going to be good, you're going to fail. And that's the message. And indeed, the same thing is true of the district attorney, who is vicious. He's not portrayed as a good guy in the story. He's a bad guy and unhappy. Right? So he is trying to do good. Right? He's trying to do good. But he can't because he's undermined by his own emotions, by his own hatred, by his own ideas. So there is no good character fully in the movie, but if you compare the district attorney and who's trying to get Axelrod and Bobby Axelrod, clearly Bobby Axelrod is the more likable character, even if you know he's not going to be happy and he's not a good guy. He's likable. All right. I do want to, let me show you just for a difference. Now here you've got a clip of the Greed speech from Wall Street. I'm going to show you this. Let me see if we're going to get it. There it is. Okay. And I want you to note about this a couple of things, right? One, remember, this clip was written by Oliver Stone. It was written by an explicit Marxist. And yet, I think, you know, I haven't listened to the clip in a while, so let's see if I still agree with myself. Everything said in this clip is true. This is actually one of the best defenses of corporate hostile takeovers, raiders, so on. This is a clip in which Geico is trying to convince shareholders to get rid of the board of directors and replace them with his people. Replace them in an effort to make money. And you'll see that really everything he says is right. Later in the movie, he undercuts it all. Later in the movie, he will say, life's a zero-sum game. That's just me manipulating people. I don't believe any of that. But here, in the speech, the actual words that he says, they're true. So we're going to watch it and see.
The new law of evolution in corporate America seems to be survival of the unfittest. Well, in my book, you either do it right or you get eliminated. In the last seven deals that I've been involved with, there were 2.5 million stockholders who have made a pre-tax profit of $12 billion. Thank you. I am not a destroyer of companies. I am a liberator of them. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, that greed, for lack of a better word, is good. Greed is right. Greed works. Greed clarifies, cuts through, and captures the essence of the evolutionary spirit. Greed, in all of its forms, greed for life, for money, for love, knowledge, has marked the upward surge of mankind, and greed, you mark my words, will not only save Teldar Paper, but that other malfunctioning corporation called the USA. Thank you very much.
Great. Note the music. This isn't serious. That was just a joke. None of that was right. Now, that... Whoops. Let me just get that. Get rid of that. That was a shortened version of the speech. I recommend you go and you find the longer version. The longer version is much better. He talks about all the inefficiency in the company. He talks about all the vice presidents over there doing nothing. He talks about what he would do to change the company and make the company more profitable and better. And the way he uses greed there is greed to make things better, to create, to build, to produce. But then Oliver Stone immediately overcuts him as soon as he ends with a Frank Sinatra song called Take Me to the Moon, basically telling everybody, no, this is frivolous. This is not real. This is a joke. Don't take anything he just said seriously. But actually what he says in that speech is true. It is the passionate pursuit of one's own happiness, passionate pursuit of money, the passionate pursuit of knowledge, the passionate pursuit of anything that has moved the world forward. It is self-interest. And if greed is a single-mindedness, a passion around something, then greed is a good thing. Now, greed can be used in a negative context. I'm not going to fight over the term greed. But clearly, greed, if it's a single-minded pursuit of greed for love, he uses that in the speech. What's wrong with greed for love? So first, I recommend a longer version of the speech. I guess I brought up, for some reason, a short version. It's excellent. It's intellectual. It identifies the truth in ways that you won't hear in almost any other movie. Unfortunately, it's in the middle of a Marxist movie that is meant to undercut everything that he says and means you. And it just shows how sophisticated Oliver Stone is that he can put something like that together. One other speech I'd recommend, I'm not going to show it, but I'd recommend, I think, the best of all of these speeches, but also kind of funny because it's a speech delivered by Danny DeVito. And it is the best speech about finance I've ever seen. It's excellent. And so I highly, highly recommend that. It's in other people's money. Now, you know, what the hell? I wonder if I can bring it up and we can see that. Let's see. All right, you want another speech? You want the speech from other people's money? This is the best speech you will find. Let's see. I just want to make sure it's the right one.
Amen.
All right, yeah, that's the right one. Always good when a speech starts with amen. Here we go. Let's see if I can find it. You apologize. It's going to take me a second here. Nope, that's not it. There it is. Okay. All right, there it is. The other people's money. Let's just do this, fit it into the screen better. Know that they cast Danny DeVito in this role, right? By the way, opposite Gregory Peck, who plays the altruist, nice guy altruist type in the movie. But okay, so we're gonna center this. Okay, that's good enough. All right, the main thing is for you to hear the speech, more than anything else. All right, so here's Danny DeVito's speech in Other People's Money on a very similar topic than what we've heard in the past. And You tell me what you think of this. Now, remember, you haven't seen the movie. So he is trying to take over a company that makes wire and cable. This is in the early 90s. He wants to take it over and break it up and sell the assets to the highest bidder. So he's going to lay off all the employees, and he's going to split the company up, and he's talking to shareholders. And the current CEO of the company has just given a speech about how The company needs to take care of its stakeholders. How important all its employees are. They're going to run into the loss, and things are going to happen, and the yen is going to do that. You know, things are going to happen, and the company's going to be successful. But it's all wishful thinking. And notice the whole speech previously is wishful thinking, and notice how Danny DeVito handles that. This is great writing.
Amen. And amen. And amen. You have to forgive me, I'm not familiar with the local custom. Where I come from, you always say amen after you hear a prayer. Because that's what you just heard. A prayer.
Yeah, wishful thinking is a prayer, and he diagnoses it exactly. Danny DeVito's not interested in prayers. He's interested in facts.
Where I come from, that particular prayer is called the prayer for the dead. You just heard the prayer for the dead, my fellow stockholders, and you didn't say amen. This company is dead. I didn't kill it. Don't blame me. It was dead when I got here. It's too late for prayers. For even if the prayers were answered, and a miracle occurred, and the yen did this, and the dollar did that, and the infrastructure did the other thing, we would still be dead. You know why? Fiber optics. New technologies.
Notice how fact-oriented it is. Reality-oriented it is.
Obsolescence. We're dead, all right. We're just not broke. And do you know the surest way to go broke? Keep getting an increasing share of a shrinking market. Down the tubes. Slow but sure.
That's, imagine you're the last buggy company in the world. And the automobile is about, and you're going to stick with the buggies forever. Increasing share of the market in a market that is shrinking and disappearing.
You know, at one time, there must have been dozens of companies making buggy whips.
There we go. There's my example. I stole it from Danny DeVito.
And I'll bet the last company around was the one that made the best goddamn buggy whip you ever saw. Now, how would you have liked to have been a stockholder in that company? You invested in a business, and this business is dead. Let's have the intelligence. Let's have the decency to sign the death certificate, collect the insurance, and invest in something with a future. Ah, but we can't, goes the prayer. We can't, because we have a responsibility. A responsibility to our employees, to our community. What will happen to them? I got two words for that. Who cares?
Perfect.
Care about them? Why? They didn't care about you. They sucked you dry. You have no responsibility to them. For the last 10 years, this company bled your money. Did this community ever say, we know times are tough. We'll lower taxes, reduce water and sewer. Check it out. You're paying twice what you did 10 years ago. And our devoted employees, who have taken no increases for the past 3 years, are still making twice what they made 10 years ago. And our stock, 1/6. What it was 10 years ago. Who cares? I'll tell you. Me. I'm not your best friend. I'm your only friend. I don't make anything. I'm making you money. And lest we forget, that's the only reason any of you became stockholders in the first place. You want to make money. You don't care if they manufacture wire and cable, fry chicken, or grow tangerines.
All right, looks like we were blocked. Stream was dropped. Are we back? Can you guys hear me on YouTube? Can you hear me? One, two, three. All right, so somehow we got back. I'm not sure how we got back, but we are back. All right, we're back. All right. So, as you noticed, they wouldn't let me play this clip. Maybe, I guess I violated the copyright. You know, it's hard to tell what the rules are, given that these videos appear on YouTube, and they don't have any statements about what the copyright is exactly. So I thought what I was doing was consistent with fair use, but maybe not. So I don't think they sent, you know, they stopped me because of the content. I think they stopped me because I was showing videos of movies that I shouldn't have been doing. So that's fine. You know, they're right. I have no objection to that. Would have been good if they had a warning and let you know, oh, no, you're showing too much of this. Anyway, that is a great speech. I can't show it to you, but funnily enough, without paying anybody any money, you can go on YouTube and watch the whole thing, and nobody's going to block you from doing that. So please go and watch. It's from Other People's Money. Danny DeVito plays Larry the Liquidator, and Gregory Peck plays his nemesis. The whole movie is excellent. It, you know, from a perspective of finance, Larry the Liquidator never says anything that is wrong. I could show you clip after clip after clip from that movie that is all true and right. So anyway, I hope you enjoyed that. You know, again, I recommend Billions, if only because Bobby has an amazing sense of life. It's just too bad that we have this dichotomy. Again, happiness versus virtue. Success versus virtue. Wealth versus virtue. And it's not new. It's been around forever, right? When I was growing up, I had a second, third cousin, something like that, who was a millionaire. And you know, millionaire. There weren't many millionaires in our family. I think he was the only one. And my mother told me, she said, he's a crook. I said, what do you mean? She said, you can't be a millionaire unless you're a crook. He's done crooked stuff. He's done, you know, he's done crooked stuff. Every millionaire, she said, is a crook. That is an attitude that people have. Again, if you're successful, you must not be virtuous. That straight out of Immanuel Kant. Now, Darius asks, can you be happy and virtuous? Absolutely. The only way to be happy is to be virtuous. You cannot be happy unless you're virtuous. Indeed, the purpose of virtue, the purpose of morality, is happiness. It's only the moral code of Christianity, the conventional moral code that we've all bought into. It's only that moral code that says that since virtue means sacrifice, virtue means living for others, virtue means giving up your values, then of course you cannot be happy. They build it in that you must fail. Mother Teresa was miserable. She hated life. She was depressed. She even questioned her religion because life was miserable. Why? Because she wasn't pursuing her values. She wasn't pursuing her life. She wasn't pursuing her happiness. She was acting out of a sense of duty, following Christian morality, which leads to nothing but self-destruction. So if you hold the morality of altruism, the more consistently you hold it, the more consistently unhappy you will be. It's only to the extent that you reject it. It's only to the extent that you follow your rational self-interest in one aspect of your life or another. Only to that extent can you be happy. So Ayn Rand provides us, Ayn Rand articulates for us a morality. She discovers a morality of self-interest. A morality where the highest purpose of man is his own happiness. Vonda, thank you. Very generous again today. She likes it when I talk about happiness. I've noticed that. It's the whole purpose of morality is to guide us towards happiness. If you have the right virtues, and the most important of those virtues is using your mind, is to be rational, then you will achieve happiness. If you don't have the right virtues, you will not achieve happiness. In a sense, morality is a guide to how to be successful at living. And what is the ultimate success at living? It's happiness. So, yes, you can be. Don't buy in to the conventional view. Indeed, the founding fathers didn't believe that virtue and happiness were opposites. In the whole Enlightenment project, in spite of the religious influence, the whole Enlightenment project, to some extent, is this idea that happiness is possible by pursuing virtue. But they get the virtues wrong, so it looks like a failed project. What Ayn Rand does is she comes in and gets the virtues right. Because of how she builds, she induces her morality from reality, from the principles, the concretes, the things that actually make human being happy. She studies history. She studies psychology. She looks around at people around her. And she says, what leads to human success? Her whole beginning is survival, life. Well, what leads to life? You can't be happy if you're not alive. You can't be happy if you don't pursue the values necessary for life. Well, what are those? And all those consistent with every other aspect of life, of flourishing and success. And yes, it's the same value that leads to your life necessarily as the values that lead to your success, to your prosperity, to your happiness. And happiness is indeed everything. It's what it's all about. So Rand starts with reality and induces the principles that are necessary to be successful in reality. By observing, by looking around, by seeing, by studying what is success, what leads to success. Can selfishness be excessive in a bad way? And do you call it something different when it is? No, I don't think selfishness can be excessive, not properly understood. Selfishness is pursuing your rational long-term interests. That's what selfishness means. You cannot be excessively rational. You cannot be excessively long-term, although I guess you can if you take it out of the realm of human life. You cannot be excessively rational. So you can, if you have a wrong view of selfishness, let me take these off. If you have a view of selfishness that says, do whatever they feel like, do whatever, you know, exploit other people, do whatever, then yes, then obviously that can be excessive. But that isn't a good idea even in small doses. So if you have a proper definition of selfishness and conceptualize it properly in your own mind, and you focus on rationally pursuing your own interests, which includes, by the way, the people you love and the people who are out there, human beings that produce, that make your life, that help make your life possible. When you think of the world rationally, then there's no such thing as excessive selfishness. The more selfish you are, the more you're pursuing your own self-interest, the more you're thinking, the more you're producing, the more honest you are, the more integrity you have. I mean, that's all good. That's not bad. Single-mindedly pursuing selfishness is what morality demands. I mean, it doesn't demand. It demands, but it's not demanding of you as a duty. It's demanding of you it's what it teaches. That's a better word. It's what it teaches. How did society get to the point where people are motivated to convince a person not to have pride for his achievement? It's monstrous. That's how did society get to this point? It's always been like this. Oh, not always, but mostly. I mean, this is Christianity. This is what Christianity means. Right? Don't be prideful. Be humble. Show humility. You are nothing. You're a speck. God is everything. You must serve God, not yourself, not your own interest, not your life, not your happiness. God. Where is he? What does he want? Listen, I know. Just do what I tell you, because I talk to God, and I know what he wants. That's religion. Religion undermines your epistemology. You don't know the truth. Only God does. It undermines your pride. You didn't build it. God did. That's why when you catch that football in the end zone, first thing you do is thank God. Of course, none of those athletes really believe that. But it's interesting, in football they do that. They don't do that in basketball. When they score a basket, they don't thank God. Some of them, maybe some of them do. One of the things I like about Michael Jordan is he never did. So religion, particularly Christianity's always had this. And Immanuel Kant secularized it philosophically. And since then, philosopher after philosopher after philosopher have rejected the idea of pride. They rejected the idea of you built that. You deserve it. It is yours. And have rejected the idea of happiness and morality as being consistent. Morality leads to unhappiness because it requires sacrifice. So if you see somebody happy, be suspicious. Don't trust them. They must have pursued their own self-interest. This is a weird question. How did Leonard Peikoff meet Benito Mussolini? He didn't. How could he have? No way he did. Where did you get that from? I didn't say that, so I don't know where that came from. All right. He put money in it, so I answered it. Do altruists know on some level that they have to destroy your soul and spirit to get what they want. These corona face masks were not for our protection. They are a sign of submission, like burqas in Islamic countries. I think you're taking that too far, but let's start with altruism. Yeah, I mean, I do think they, to some extent, deep down, those who really preach altruism know that what they're trying to do is destroy you as an individual. Because an individual, somebody who cares about himself, somebody who's different, somebody who's differentiated, is not a good altruist. It's not somebody that can be. So they have to destroy that which is within you that makes you an individual, and that's your soul. So you clearly have to destroy your soul and your spirit. And the more intellectual, the more insightful about them know that. Whether they can hold that in their heads, whether they can hold that in their mind, or they bury it, evade it, it's hard to tell. But they have to know it to some extent. Now, let me just say about face masks. I'm not convinced about face masks. And let me give you the only reason I'm not convinced about face masks, in terms of they're about submission and they're not really good for you and they're really bad for you and all this stuff. The only reason I'm skeptical that the reason they're pushing face masks is there's no reason to push face masks is that Asians wear face masks in Asia. And that countries where face masks are used extensively have suffered the least from the coronavirus. Japan is a great example of this. If you walk around even in normal times in a Japanese street, there's a significant number of people wearing face masks. Anybody who has the snivels, anybody who has a cold, out of respect for other people and not wanting other people to catch their cold, wears a face mask. It's very considerate. And during Corona, everybody wore face masks. Not because the government told them to. Indeed, the government didn't tell them to. There wasn't the same kind of commandments coming down from the government as they usually are. Wow, Brian, thank you. I really appreciate that. And yet, Japan has got very little of this. Even though they didn't do as much testing, they didn't do as well as Korea, they still don't have a lot of coronavirus. They don't have a lot of deaths. They don't have a lot of people in hospitals. They've just eliminated the emergency room. And it could be, I don't know, I don't think it's proven, but it could be that part of that is, that part of that is the face mask. I don't know that, but I'm willing to give it a benefit of a doubt. The same in Taiwan, where they wear a lot of face masks, Hong Kong, Singapore, and South Korea. They wear a lot of face masks in those places, and those places have done very, very well during the coronavirus. So I think some people would like the face mask to be a sign of submission, but I don't think that's not what I would wear a face mask. And I'm torn because I don't like wearing them, and I'm not 100% convinced that they are beneficial, but I don't also 100% reject that they're beneficial. I just prefer just to stay away from people, keep my distance. And if I keep my distance, I think that's fine. I don't think you need a face mask. But if you're going to be close up with people, it's probably not a bad idea. Probably not a bad idea. Again, I don't think it's some big conspiratorial thing. And I think the CDC changed its mind about face masks. Not because it was influenced by power-lusting governors or power-lusting politicians. It changed his mind about face masks because they looked at Asia and the results in Asia were much better than the results in the West. And they hypothesized that face masks might have something to do with that. And they changed their mind about face masks only after that happened. Indeed, initially, the CDC was against face masks for the reasons that Amesh Adalja has expressed. But I think they looked at Asia and they saw success there. And they said, we might as well mimic as much as possible what they do. And this was part of it. Did the German civilian population know the extent of the Holocaust during the war? Or did the Nazis do a good job hiding their genocide? The German civilians who are willing to think. The German civilians who actually were not burying their head in the sand absolutely knew. And you can find testaments of this. Oh, there's a wonderful German movie about this. I'll try to remember the name. I can't remember the name of the movie. About the fact that after the war, after the concentration camps were liberated, all of that was happened. German population pretended they didn't know it happened. They completely evaded all of that. And indeed, until 52 or 53, there was no mention of Auschwitz, no mention of the Holocaust, nothing about the Holocaust within German society. It was as if it never happened until one brave soul started bringing out the evidence and revealing it. And he was a man who had been a teenager during World War II and didn't know that it had happened. And suddenly discovered it and was shocked by the evasion. But when he went to his parents and he confronts them, did you know? They knew. They didn't want to know. They want to pretend it wasn't going on. But they knew. They knew. And of course, there were the Nuremberg trials. And Germans knew about those trials. They knew the evidence from those trials. So after the war, they certainly knew. And they still managed to evade. So it was a massive evasion. Some of them supported it. Some of them pretended it didn't happen. Some of them evaded it. Some of them objected to it but stayed quiet. And some fought. A very, very tiny fraction of the German population fought. But if you were even mildly a thinking person, if you were listening to what was going on, or looking and listening to what was going around you, you knew. You pretended you didn't, but you knew. I need to find the name of that movie. It was quite a stunning movie. If you're anxious about making your parents proud of you, is that second-handed? Yeah, at the end of the day, it is. You don't live for your parents. Now, if you love your parents and you have a good relationship with your parents, you generally want them to think good things about you. But that shouldn't be a driver. It shouldn't be a driver of what you do. And it shouldn't affect you emotionally the way it does, particularly if you think your parents are irrationally overly critical of you, like most parents are. So that's a good issue to go talk to a psychologist about, to try to undo that fear, that anxiousness, that demand. So don't judge yourself in terms of, is that second-handed? Anxious is an emotion. Anxiety is an emotion. You don't judge your emotions in that way. Oh, I'm a second-hand, I'm a bad person. Yeah, well, we all have altruism and second-handedness ingrained in us to some extent, because that's the world we live in. What you got to do is get a good psychologist, or just think about, why am I feeling anxious? Try to do the psychology yourself. But you got to change that emotional response. And part of that comes from gaining more self-esteem, more confidence, more pride. And part of that might be, because it's at the emotional level, might require some psychological work. Contrary to the characterization of Trump as 3D chess player, isn't a second-hander able to be easily manipulated by shrewd people? Yeah, I don't think Trump's a 3D chess player. I don't think he's a 2D chess player. And I don't know what a 1D chess player would be. So I think a second-hander absolutely is easily manipulated. And I think Trump is easily manipulated by people around him. You can see how quickly he changes his mind about stuff, depending on who's spoken to him, you know, the day before. Open up the economy, but don't open up in Georgia, and open up here, but not over there, and do this, don't do that. He is clearly being swayed by the scientists, by the political forces, by being pissed off at these people or those people. So no, I don't think there's much 3D chess being played. And I think there's a lot of manipulation going on. I think Trump is very much a narcissistic second-hander who relies on feedback from others to decide, to determine his own self-worth. All right, we'll call that a day. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, particularly Vonda and Brian, for your unbelievably generous contributions. I think this might be the best Super Chat day we've ever had. If we add everybody up, so thank you guys for that. You make this show possible, so thank you for all the people who support the show. That is terrific. We will be back, when will we be back? Probably on Friday. So take the day off tomorrow, and probably on Friday with the show. And until then, don't forget to like, don't forget to share. Keep pursuing that happiness. Don't give up on happiness, and don't give up on virtue. The one is necessary for the other. You can't achieve happiness without virtue. That's the most important thing to take out of this. And of course, I enjoy billions. I enjoy big characters. And I'd rather have a big character than Bobby Axelrod, than movies portraying meek, pathetic, you know, crawling beings that have no sense of self, have no confidence, have no, you know, no spirit of life. So with all Bobby Axelrod's flaws, I love his spirit. I love his sense of life. I love his energy. I love his passion. I love his confidence. Thanks, everybody. Have a great night. I'll talk to you all in a couple of days. Bye.